hi everyone online. We have quite a lot of people online, quite a lot of our former students as well as new people. So thank you so much for joining us tonight for this biggest demo day in Tokyo, biggest Le Wagon demo day in Tokyo. This is actually our, I believe, 25th or even more than that demo day in Tokyo. We've been around for the past 5 years. And tonight, like I said, is the biggest demo day. We'll have 54 people pitching. So before you run away, that means 15 different pitches. And we decided to organize it a little bit so that you can follow at home, so that you know a little bit what's going on. So we will start with all of our data science projects. We'll have 5 data science pitches. Then we'll move on to our web development projects. So if you want to have an idea of the order, this is how we're going to do. So before we get started, before I leave the room to our data science students, I would like to talk a little bit about Le Wagon really quickly. For those of you who don't know us, Le Wagon is a coding bootcamp. As you know, we teach both web development and data science in both part-time and full-time formats. So the students that you'll see pitching tonight, they've been with us either full-time for 9 weeks, either part-time for 24 weeks, and they've been studying web development and data science. I'll start with the data science because it's going to be the next pitches. So for the data science people, they study for 9 and 24 weeks, and they've been studying quite a lot. They start with Python, they go through very deep concept of data analysis, and then move on to more advanced data science concept like machine learning, deep learning, and how to put their models into production. So this is actually what you're going to be witnessing tonight, their final application, their final projects. And without further ado, because we have a lot of pitches to go through, I would like to invite the very, very first data science project on stage, and actually not on stage, online. So for this very first project, we have Riyad, who joined the whole bootcamp from Vietnam. He was with us for 6 months from Vietnam. I think he deserves a big, big round of applause. Let's welcome Riyad.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for the introduction, Sylvain. Welcome to the big demo day. So I'm Riyad from the part-time data science batch 719. And thanks for having me first. That's a good thing. Anyway, without further ado, let's start. Tonight, I will present you a football transfer recommendation system, OptiRecruit. So like right now, so you might wonder how plugging data to football transfer decisions is important, or how it could actually solve football transfer problems. So let's take a few steps back and get perspective. Nowadays, the amount of money circulating in the football ecosystem is huge, and you name it. You have like a huge player salaries, crazy football TV rights, contract sponsoring, NFTs now, and our topics of tonight, transfer fees. So in that graph, what you can see is the evolution of the money spent since 2012 in the transfer windows. And what is actually crazy is like up to 2019, like the amount of money kept increasing with like a really crazy year in 2017, with like almost 50% growth year on year. The other thing that you can notice is like starting 2020, there is a decrease which was due to COVID. And this highlights that football transfers are nowadays decisions more and more business driven. And when it comes down to business, some teams are actually doing much better than others. So let's take a look at those examples. So we have like 3 recent transfers that happened like in the past 4 years that show movements of the 3 players that you're seeing when they joined the team and then left it. What you can see actually from the get-go is like Juventus actually lost a lot of money when trading Cristiano Ronaldo, while Dortmund and Southampton managed to make a lot of money. despite all the external factors, one of the reasons of those successes in terms of transfer is due to the data approach to recruitment that Southampton and Borussia Dortmund has made, which is what we call Moneyball, or finding the undervalue that could be like we said, for higher value in the market. So if we look again at the Borussia Dortmund approach and examples, in addition of Jadon Sancho, they actually managed to make 150 million euro by trading Ousmane Dembele and Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang. So when we were actually framing our problem and how we can help, we were wondering how we can help professional teams achieve the same successes as Dortmund. And that's where we come in with our goal, which was to create a platform to identify undervalued replacements for specific players. So how we did this? We actually broke down the problem in three main steps. So the first one was to actually predict the next year transfer value for each of the players that we have in our database, then build a recommendation matrix for each of those players, and then plug the prediction and recommendation API in a Heroku app. So that being said, let's move to the demonstration of our platform and see how it looks like if we use it. So actually, just as a quick FYI, when you land to the page, we have a quick description of how things are happening. So the data set that we're using is about like 20,000 plus players. And the way that we actually display the information is like we plugged the predicted transfer values with a standard linear regression, and then give a score based on similarity, a cosine similarity for players. You might ask yourself why cosine similarities, because that way of computing similarities is like better when we capture style. Just as a quick example, if we just consider stats alone, in a specific space, Lionel Messi in here and Cristiano Ronaldo in here are actually really close to each other. But if we take into account that player, João Félix, which is actually quite similar to Lionel Messi, because of his stats, which are not on par of those two great players, we can't actually get a good recommendation. So the actually pluses of cosine similarity is like the angle that you see is actually making João Félix much more similar to Messi than Ronaldo is similar to Messi, which makes sense. Anyway, moving on to the demo, we have like two use cases that we want to present. So let's say that, for example, we want to replicate the success story that we've seen for Ousmane Dembele, like when he was joining, when he was like transferred from Borussia Dortmund, and when he came, and when he was transferred to FC Barcelona. Okay, the API is taking a little bit of time. Sorry about that. So yeah, so what we end up with is actually a list of 100 recommendations for that player. And if we were actually to refine our filters, and let's say that we have like a potential limits in terms of budget, and they say that we don't want to spend more than 25 million of euros. And looking at the results, we can see that the distribution of the players like, is ranging from 21 years old to 32. And we want to identify someone who has like a potential growth for the future. We might want to actually filter again on the maximum age. And let's say that we want to do for 25. In here, what we can see, like we have six recommended players, which are actually making sense in terms of what could happen. If it was me, actually, that would like need to scout someone, I would actually check what's happening with the number two, Callum Hudson-Odoi, which has been performing well whenever he was playing, or maybe the guy called Jefferson Soteldo. But then the potential outcome of this recommendation was like, as a manager, we could ask some scouts company to actually provide a more detailed report on those players and see who's actually really affordable or not. Then actually, let's move on to the second use case. It's like, let's go to the Real Madrid squad. Okay. And we know, I mean, as a manager, let's assume that I know one of my player is not happy, which is like Ferland Mendy, for example, and we might need to replace him in the current transfer window. So knowing this, I want to know, for example, what are the potential replacement that I could have if I were to sell him and use that money to buy a new player. And among all the players that I'm seeing here, I can see like the market value is ranging from like 8 million to something like super expensive up to 40 million. And from there, I was like, because we have like budget constraints due to COVID, again, let's say that I want to spend maximum 30 million euro and I want someone who's actually young so that I can expect, again, more growth. And then from there, from the list of recommendation, we have actually some names which are actually making quite some sense. And just based on the growth potential, I will go with number 7, Predosa, because he's about like, he's supposed to grow by 7 points in terms of rating on FIFA dataset. And that's pretty much it. So if you're curious, we can share the link and you can play around to see what can happen. And if you have questions, reach out to us and we'll be happy to answer. Thank you. That would be all.
I would like to invite Lam and Tony on stage for their crypto presentation. Let's welcome them on stage.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lam. There's 3 members in our team, myself, Tony, and TJ, who will be our master presentation from joining us from Korea. So without further ado, let's begin. Well, welcome to the world of cryptocurrencies prices forecasting. How many of you in the room know about crypto? Raise your hand. Okay, so probably about quite a lot, actually. Probably about 50%. Before we commence, we must hold you in suspense because there is a disclaimer we need to dispense. We may make you wiser, but we are not financial advisors. Please consult a financial dude if you are in the investing mood. This presentation is mainly for entertainment and educational purpose only. Let's quickly talk about cryptocurrency 101 and some context. So you're probably aware that crypto has been around for more than 10 years by now, but crypto price is actually very hard to forecast. And there's about 4 reasons for this. One is that prices are very volatile, highly volatile. It can change up and down in just a matter of days, right? And it's a non-regulated asset by financial service authority in the US, Japan, many other countries. It's heavily affected by human emotions and influences. And also it has a high correlation with the stock market as well. So next I will quickly talk about the average crypto investor. Right? He or she is a risk taker by nature, but generally is very uninformed about the market sentiment. In general, you can see that he usually, in the beginning, make a lot of bad trades, right? So this kind of shows that we make a lot of bad trades over time, and that's typically the average crypto investor. So next, I will quickly talk about the 2 problems, the main problems that the crypto investor face. One is that he or she doesn't know which direction price will go. Would go up or would tank? In the photo. So we have our solution. We use ML machine learning and deep learning algorithm to forecast future prices. And we also tell them of when to invest. Okay. So using our market sentiment analysis. So without further ado, I'm going to let Tony quickly walk over the demonstration of our app.
All right, everybody. So here you have our intro page to our website. So as you visit us, this is just a quick blurb talking about who we are and why we do this, as well as a further disclaimer on the bottom there. As once again, this is not financial advice. This, you do make decision based on our information at your own risk. So without further ado, let us do some forecasting. So due to internet constraints, we are only going to use 1 coin. But we do have models built for 2 other coins as well. So the first model we're going to show you is the profit model for short-term predictions. So on the left-hand side of the model, you can see the previous historical prices of the Bitcoin, as well as on the right-hand side, you can see our prediction in blue. The solid line is the prediction, where the shaded region is the 95% confidence interval that we give it. So the next model we have is another short-term prediction called Sarimax model. And it's going to take a couple seconds to load. Oh, right here. Here it is. So again, same as before, the left-hand side is our historical data, and our right-hand side is our prediction in solid, as well as our confidence interval in shaded. And last but not least, we have a long-term projection model based on deep learning called LSTM. So just as before, we have our historical data on the left, as well as our prediction on the right. And I will hand it over to my colleague, Lam, for the next part.
Next, we'll quickly talk about the fiat greed index and why this matters. This is a very simple sentiment indicator to basically tell you when is a good time to invest, right? So when the market is in extremely fearful mode, it means that it's probably a good time to buy. You know, in general, you probably might have heard of the phrase buy the dip, right? Referring to this. And when the market is extremely greedy, you might want to be a little bit more cautious, because it means that the prices may drop in the near future. Right? It means there might be a correction in the future. If it's neutral, we don't know what direction it will go. And so how do we use this app, right? And this app fits into the overall crypto investing picture. Of course, you're also welcome to download our prediction data and now historical data for further analysis. But I will talk about how it fits into the overall picture of investing later. But now let's switch back to our presentation. And Tony will quickly explain about our first two models.
The first model that we have is called the Facebook profit model. So the wonderfulness about this model is that it takes in the data and it analyzes the data for general trends, seasonal trends, as well as holiday trends. And it adds up those trends to make prediction for the future. So it's very easy to implement, but at the same time, because it's so easy, there's not a lot of things we can tweak to improve our model. Which brings us to our next model, the Sarimax model. So this model takes in the relationship from the previous data to the current data and uses that relationship to make future predictions. And because of this, there's a lot of things we can tweak and adjust to make our model better. But at the same time, there's not a lot. The long-term projection is not as accurate as we would like it to be. And that brings us to our last model.
And our deep learning model, long short-term memory algorithm, is basically comprised of five different layers here. It takes in data from the previous historical 30 days and feed it through the first two layers, LSTM, for learning the pattern of the data. And then it consolidates in a dense layer. And then afterward, it removes the unnecessary noise or irrelevant information. Afterward, it gives our price prediction for the 44th day, so 14 days after the 30th day, right? And so the main benefit of this model is that it can learn the pattern of the long-term data, or the long-term pattern of the data. And the main con is that the model is not easily configurable for different options. Right? So next, let's talk about our evaluation of the models when we use it to forecast the closing price of Bitcoin. So the metric we'll use here is called mean absolute percentage error. And to put it very simply, let's say if the price of Bitcoin is about $10,000 and the predicted or forecast price is $9,900, that is a 1% error, right? And in general, the lower the make, the better it is. So we can see from here that the 1 day and 5 day make for Sarimax and profit outperform the LSTM or long-term model. But over the long term, if you want to forecast a price of 14 days or 3 months, then LSTM would be the answer to the model of choice for the long term. So with that said, let's go towards about how our app will help and how it fits into the big picture guidance of the crypto world, right? So we have talked about how our app help to solve the two main problems. One is the uncertainty about prices. It will help to forecast the future prices. And also second, it will also help to get a TAM to inform the investor about the timing for investment using a fear and greed index indicator. But we must remind you again that there are multitude of other factors to check before investing. And it's your own personal responsibility, right? That's the first thing. And so you need to evaluate the risk of the investor. You also need to check the general market sentiment for the stock and also the technical analysis, if you know about it, or the tokenomics of the coin that you're interested in. But in the end, it's one responsibility when it comes to financial investment. And with that said, that's the end of our presentation. I would like to thank all the TA and at the Wagon for helping us over the past 2 months. I also would like to thank my team, TJ, who's been building the Docker, the front end for this app, Tony for building the two models and many other critical functions. Myself, I'm the general architect and also the meme creator. So with that said, let's go to the moon and thank you.
Let's welcome Lee for SmackBang.
Cool. Well, congratulations everyone to making it to the finish line. On behalf of our whole team, I'm very excited to present our project called SmackBang. So we're a team of four data scientists dispersed across the globe. And while we love hanging out on Zoom and collaborating on Slack channels, nothing beats face-to-face. But what we found is that there's no simple way to find a place to meet that's smack bang in the middle. You'd have to spend hours trawling websites, creating spreadsheets, going back and forth comparing flight prices just to find a handful of destinations that's within your budget. And then you'd have to figure out if some of these random locations are actually good places to meet up. So what we did is we created an app that helps bring people together by recommending the best places to meet in the middle. And with such a global community such as Le Wagon, I'm sure this is something that we can all relate to, not just as alumni, but for relationships, families, friends, and our ability to do business, especially during the COVID era. So to help with the flight search process, we've also created some tools to help you compare prices for each traveler, as well as compare the destinations themselves. So with that being said, let's jump over to our app and have a look at it now. So this is our SmackBang homepage, and two of our team members are in Australia and Japan. So all we ask is that you enter in the origin for each airport. So let's say Sydney for origin one, and then for origin two, we'll enter in Tokyo. We choose our travel date. So let's look ahead at, let's say the 4th, an optional return date. We can choose the continent that they want to meet up in, as well as the preferred currency for the results. And then we just smack bang our destinations. So it's a very simple user interface, but a lot of work is going on right now in the background to fetch these results. So before we see the results, let's have a look at what's actually going on. So the SmackBang app was created using Streamlit and deployed on Heroku. And right now the app is contacting our SmackBang API, which is stored in a Docker container deployed on Google Cloud Run. And it's actually fetching thousands of flights from Kiwi.com. And then SmackBang is sifting through all these flights to find the best places to meet in the middle. We then take these best flights and destinations, and we then feed it into a flight fare prediction model, which is based on a historic flight fare data set from Kaggle. And we then feed it into a sentiment analysis model using recent tweets from Twitter. We then use this analysis to help our users gauge whether the prices from Kiwi.com are reasonable or not, and then also to take a quick pulse on the actual vibe of the potential destinations. We also have a map displaying our locations, and we use that, we display that using a static CSV with all that location information. So let's have a look at the results. Okay, so on the right-hand side, we've got a little map here that's 3D, and you can zoom around and navigate. So what we're looking at here are our pink endpoints are our two data scientists in Sydney and Tokyo. The blue endpoints are our potential destinations. And by hovering above each of the flight paths, you get a little tooltip with a title, a tag, and the image of the potential destination. On the left-hand side, we've got our top recommended destinations, and these are based on the combined fare price. And these are the actual fare prices from Kiwi.com and SmackBang. And again, we have the actual flight prices for our two data scientists in Sydney and Tokyo. In the middle, we have some traffic light signals, and these are coming from our flight fare prediction model. So green lights mean that if you were to book on Kiwi.com right now, then those flights would be cheaper than average based on our model. Orange means that they're about average, and red just means that they're more expensive on average compared to our model. Next, we've got our destination vibe, and this is coming from our sentiment analysis. From our tweets. And here we just have a simple thumbs up, thumbs down indication of the general vibe of those locations. So everything's looking pretty sweet right now. And in the last column, we just have two links here for each of our guys to go ahead and quickly book their tickets and off they go. So now that you've seen the site in action, let's take a quick peek at what's going on with the actual two models that we use to help our users pick their destinations. So for the first fare prediction model, a lot of work was done to pre-process and feature engineer the data before training. And then based on our selected features and our target, we decided that the mean absolute error and R2 score for our models would be the best metrics to base our baseline models to beat. And so what we did is we trained and evaluated a bunch of different models, and we iterated through lots of different machine learning algorithms and model parameters. And we continued this process until we found a model that gave us the best score. And so out of this process, we landed on XGBoost. XGBoost stands for Extreme Gradient Boosting. And simply put, it is an ensemble of sequential decision trees where each decision tree gets to learn from the mistakes of its predecessor. And then the strongest performing trees will have a large impact on the final prediction. It was also designed with speed and performance in mind, and we liked that as well. And so our best model gave us a mean absolute error of $16. And that simply means that on average, our flight fare predictions will be off by about $16. We also got an R2 score of 77%. And that just means that 77% of the variance in the flight fares can be explained by our model. So what we did is we took our best middle cities and we fed them into our SmackBang prediction endpoint. And then we compared those predictions to the actual costs from Kiwi.com, and then we were able to give our good, average, and poor traffic light indicators. And then last, we had our sentiment analysis. And so here we reached out to the Twitter API and we grabbed thousands of tweets from our potential destinations. We pre-processed those tweets ready to be fed into our social media specific NLP model, which is aptly called VADA, given our introduction earlier this morning or this evening. And so VADA stands for Valence Aware Dictionary for Sentiment Reasoning. And what that basically means is that VADA has a pre-constructed dictionary with a comprehensive list of sentiment features. And these sentiment features aren't just single words like awesome or awful. It's also key phrases such as badass and the bomb, as well as like emojis and sentiment-laden acronyms such as WTF and LOL. And so what VADA does is it takes these sentiment features, it rates them on polarity and intensity, and it ranks them on a score from -4 to +4, like extremely negative and extremely positive. And so what we did is we took those results and we collated them, And we return those to the user as majority positive or majority negative for each destination to give you an indication of sort of the vibe. So just to recap, if you're looking to connect with, you know, friends and family and colleagues or even Luwagan classmates, you can come here and all of that information from our modeling and analysis and our SmackBang API can be retrieved in this one location. And you can then help you decide, you know, where you want to go next. And so to that end, lastly, but not least, I just want to thank our amazing team. We had Nordi and Ahmad, they did all the coding for our machine learning models. Paul, who also did all of the coding for our front end in Streamlit. It was a blast working with you guys. And thanks a lot to the Luwagan team and everyone who advised us and helped us along the way. You guys are amazing. Thank you.
Moving on. So you might think that data science is only for men, and this is really, really not the case. And so to prove you wrong, we will welcome Steffi on stage, who is going to pitch an amazing project. I don't want to spoil it.
Good evening to everybody and welcome. My name is Stephanie and this is my teammate Kyle. We are going to present to you our project that it's a League of Legends winner predictor. I would hope you like it. It has been done with the help of Gary and Sebastian, to which we are very thankful. So first, let's begin with what actually is League of Legends. So League of Legends is a multiplayer online battle arena video game where different players from all around the world can get to play with between each other. Now, in this game, there are going to be two teams. Each team is going to be five players, and they both will engage into player versus player combat or player versus bot combat. Now, League of Legends has a pool of playable characters. Each one of these playable characters is called a champion. Each one of the teams, either the blue team or the red team, is going to have the opportunity to take one of the champions out of the pool to build their team. So once the team is built, is going to be the draft phase where you just get the champions out of the pool and you build your teams. We must say that for League of Legends, up to today, there is more than 150 champions and there is more champions coming every season. That means that the teams that are going to be built is like a lot of permutations. It's like more than 100,000 teams that you can build with all of these champions. So, well, once you have the champions, you have the teams, where are they going to be deployed? They're going to be deployed in this map over here. The map over here will have the red team deployed on the upper side, and the blue team is going to have the half lower side. Deep in the map, you will have at the top or at the very bottom a nexus. The nexus is the thing to like destroy. You have to push all through the enemy base, all through the map, and get to the enemy heart to destroy these nexus. Anyone that destroys the nexus first wins. Is that easy? So now the thing that should be in your minds right now is like, yeah, it sounds like a pretty good game, but what should I care? And the way to answer that question is it all comes down to the numbers. So the reason why you should care is, well, League of Legends is right now arguably one of the biggest esports, and esports is moving millions of dollars every year. And also League of Legends has very big prize pools. So every year from 2015, at least $2 million are for prize pools. Not only that, just a couple of few years ago, right before Corona hit, the prize pool was $8 million. So the idea is that in this case, I want to make not any bet, not just flipping a coin and seeing like, okay, I'm going to say like which one is going to win. I want to actually make a more educated guess. And that's why we have built this app in here. So this is our app right now running in Heroku. We have, for the blue team, all these five teams that are on your left, and on the other side, on your right, you will have the red teams. In here, you will have the opportunity to choose which champions are available and put them in this app. Once you are happy with the five champions, once you have the five champions for each one of the teams, then you can press the button that says predict winner. And then we have that. In our case, with our model, the red one will win with a 61% accuracy or probability at least. And well, that's how our model is beginning to work. this is not magic. The back part of this is with machine learning. So how did we make this work? The first thing that we checked is we checked what cool stuff other people made. And in this, for League of Legends, we found two very important papers. The first one is just determined with the win percentage from the draft phase using a synergy method and the individual stats for each one of the champions. And they decided to use these three machine learning models. And the second one is this one in here, where they also consider the player champion experience, and they use these other models in here. Taking into account this literature, then we jumped on into our data. For our data, we have to be very thankful to Gary. Gary gave us 5 years of professional games. And for these professional games, we have over 30,000 games that were played from 2016 up to 2021. This data is reliable data. This has detailed information about the players, the teams, who won, creeps that were killed, anything that you can imagine is in this data. And it's impressive because with all this data, then we can build metrics that help us classify the games easily. So how did we actually make this work? We had to build our features based on the data. So for the first feature, we decided to use also a synergy score. How the synergy works is we will have one of our heroes with one of our champions. How well does it work with the other champions with the team? So we'll have these attributes in here. How well does it work with these four champions in here? And we will assign this our team synergy score. So how well they do when the five of them are playing together. The next one is going to be our role score. So coming back to the map really quickly, the map has five key positions. The five key positions are assigned to the support that it's in the back, the jungles where you can make a lot of money, and the top, middle, and bottom lanes where there are direct paths that connect both of the sides of the map. So for these five key positions, you usually have a champion that is assigned to each position. And what we want to do is the score of how well one champion from the blue side will do when it's against a champion from the red side, when they are one-to-one. In this case, we will have the blue top lane champion versus the red top lane champion. And for these two particular champions, we will have that the same role score is around 48%. And for the last feature that we engineered is the normalized win rate for a champion, that it's how well a champion does by itself. And in this case, for this guy, it's around 0.45. So that how does it look compared to the other project that we have seen. So for this awesome project, we decided to use a logit decision tree and a random forest. In the other cases, they also use decision trees. And in other cases, they also use KNN, GBoost, and deep learning neural networks. For the middle one, that they also use the synergy methods, we can see that they got around 60% accuracy, while the people that did player champion experience, they get almost 75%, 74% accuracy, which is great. So now how does our model compare to these models? We get around 68% accuracy. Now, we have only taken into account champions. We haven't taken into account player experience. And this is very nice because that means that we don't finish the project just here and just end it. We have somewhere else, like something else to do the next step outside of LeWarren, of course. And that's very nice and interesting and exciting to go ahead. Thank you very much for your attention. And I'm sorry, there is no questions, but thank you for the TAs and everybody else.
Before we dive into web development, let's have a last awesome pitch for data science. And for that, I would like to welcome Ben on stage.
My name is Ben, and along with Steven and Mizuki, we're presenting our musical data science project, Mini Mozart. Our goal was to help ordinary musicians compose great melodies with the help of the master musician, Mozart. So, a wise man once told me, in the world of music, there's harmony. And melody. And there are some people who can compose great melodies, like Mozart, and those who can't. Stephen was the wise man who told me this. So if, like me, before this project, you don't know much about music theory, a melody is a series of single notes that makes a satisfying tune. It's the part of the song that gets stuck in your head. And when a data scientist hears a series of single data points, their eyes light up. Because to a computer, that can be easy to read and potentially predictable. So our thinking was to use deep learning for that. So why use deep learning to achieve this goal? Well, the alternative would be to go to music school, which would take a long time and be very difficult. And even if you do that, whether you're a beginner like me or a practiced musician like Stephen, it's composing music can still be unintuitive, inaccessible, and intimidating. So we use deep learning to bring Mozart's music writing brain 250 years in the future to now, and use that as our melody writing assistant. We'll give our computer a series of notes, and it will try to predict what Mozart might have written next. And our thinking is that by doing this over and over, we'll come up with a nice sounding and unique melody. So much faster than going to music school, and it can become accessible, intuitive, and not intimidating. So I'll show you the tool we came up with. This is Mini Mozart. So to start off, I'll get a starting bar. So I'll just press get starting bar. And our website is spinning a roulette wheel and choosing a random Mozart melody to start off with, giving us the first 8 notes. So we can have a listen. Okay, sounds good, but maybe not my vibe. I can press the button again and get a new one. Let's listen. Okay, I like that one. That's more up my street. So I'll press start writing. And it's sending these 8 notes to our API where our model is, and giving back 3 suggestions for notes Mozart might have written next. So I've got a G, an F sharp, and a C, and maybe I'll choose the first one, a G. And you'll see it's appending to the end of our melody, and our new melody is being sent to the API again and coming back with 3 more suggestions. So let's listen to our new melody. Okay, let's choose one more. Let's choose a B flat. Okay, it's appended again, and we can listen. Okay, I like where this is going. I'm going to let Stephen come and tell you how we got to this point. And in the meantime, I'm going to finish writing my masterpiece, and I'll show you all later.
Thank you, Ben. I can't wait to hear what you come up with. So let's go a bit over the data creation process. Usually, for musicians, we use sheet music to read the music and play it. However, this is very difficult for computers to read. Luckily, we have MIDI files. One note on the sheet music corresponds to one row on this MIDI table over here. And each note has 5 features, such as the start and end time. That's the duration of the note. The pitch, which is how high or how low the note is, and velocity, which is the volume of the note. And so for pitch, the numbers are mapped to a piano keyboard like this. As you go along the keyboard, the pitch values get higher and higher. And in order to help our model learn, we had to give it lots and lots of sequences, lots of data. And so we use some data augmentation. We took each of our MIDI files and cut them up into 8 note chunks. We got every single one like this. By doing this, we were able to get 20,000 sequences from 50 different Mozart pieces. So let's get into the model creation process. A time series is a sequence of data points ordered through time. For example, the stock market prices or your heartbeat. And music is also ordered through time. So it can be thought of like a time series. And a very good deep learning model for this is recurrent neural networks, or RNN. These take the time series data to predict the next data points. For our model, we use long short-term memory, which is a type of recurrent neural network. Because RNNs are very good at remembering just a few data points behind. However, there's more substance to a melody than just a few notes. We wanted all the notes. So long short-term memory helped us do that. Our model architecture looked a bit like this. It had two separate outputs. One was the probability for pitch and one the probability for duration. And using these probabilities, Mini Mozart will suggest three different notes, which the user will choose. And by repeating that, we hope you can create a unique and sweet sounding melody. So how did our model perform? We used accuracy. So accuracy is how often, when given a Mozart melody, the predicted pitch is the same as the suggested pitches from our model. Our baseline model is if it's just choosing randomly. Hopefully our model can do better than the baseline. The Steven accuracy, I tested myself. I tried to predict the next note and duration for 15 sequences. And finally, the actual model. So my pitch accuracy was 60%. The model's was 39%, which is understandable because there are so many more categories for pitch than duration. Now, looking at duration, I got 60% again, and the model destroyed me. I got with 87%. So the model learned the rhythm of the melody really well. We learned it was difficult to emulate Mozart perfectly, but our goal was to make nice melodies, not to be perfect. So we'll see how that goes later. And we faced some challenges. So with our early models, it would often predict three notes altogether. For example, the 60, and 61, and 62. So these notes are one off from each other. So if you're predicting, for example, price, one off is good and five off would be bad. However, for melody, five off is good and one off is bad. We can understand this from the circle of fifths, which shows the harmonic relationship between notes. For example, we have a C note and an F note. On a keyboard, these are five notes apart, but on the circle of fifths, they're right next to each other, and they sound nice together. Conversely, we have a C note and a B note. They're right next to each other on the piano, but on the circle of fifths, they're on opposite sides of the circles, so they don't sound so nice together. So in order to deal with this, we decided to instead of using continuous data, like numbers for our pitches, we used categorical data. All right, that was one of our many challenges.
Okay, thanks so much, Stephen. I finished writing my melody. So you can see the first eight notes were the one Mozart gave us. And the rest are notes I wrote with the help of the suggestions from our mini Mozart. So let's listen to our melody. Okay, not too bad. I like it. I can see there's a tune there. It's not Mozart, but it's not bad. And it's definitely better than anything I would have written on my own. So I'm happy with that. So we came up with our model, and this is one of the tools we made using our model. And in the future, we could use our model for many other applications, just like this. And the possibilities are endless on that front. With that, thanks so much for listening to our pitch and my attempt at music. And thanks so much to my amazing teammates, Stephen and Mizuki. And thank you to Lowagon for an amazing 9 weeks and all the great teachers for helping get our project to here. Thank you so much. Thank you.